I took this picture in May 1994 in Rwanda, in a town called Nyanza. This man had just been liberated from a Hutu death camp by the advancing Tutsi army. And he was being brought into a Red Cross clinic, as were the other survivors. This man was a Hutu, and he did not sympathize with the genocide, and therefore he was attacked by the Hutu militia with machetes. I finally noticed him kind of sitting in a corner by himself, and I could see that he'd been badly mutilated. And I looked him in the eye, and he looked me in the eye, and he wasn't speaking. He was very weak, and he almost at one point turned his face more towards me so I could see the scars better. Rather than being ashamed, he was in a way showing to the world through me what had happened to him and to the other people in Rwanda. And I think the fact that he had given me this tacit permission to photograph him allowed me to work very intensely to try and make this picture. And I shot many frames, many rolls of film.
Foi um dos massacres mais violentos do século. O seu símbolo, a katana. Tudo começou a 6 de abril de 1994, com o assassinato do presidente do Ruanda. O país das mil colinas mergulha no horror. Algumas semanas depois, aproximadamente 1 milhão de Tutsis são assassinados pelas milícias Hutu, que executam um genocídio planeado há muito tempo. Seguindo o exemplo das Nações Unidas, que decidem retirar a maior parte das suas tropas do Ruanda no auge do massacre, a comunidade internacional fecha os olhos. Nada fez até finais de junho, a altura em que centenas de milhares de Hutus se refugiam no Zaire, tentando fugir ao avanço do exército Tutsi. Foi o maior êxodo do século a ser reportado pela imprensa de todo o mundo. A ONU reconhece finalmente o genocídio, instituindo um tribunal internacional para julgar os responsáveis pelo massacre. Boutros Ghali era secretário-geral das Nações Unidas na altura do genocídio. 4 anos mais tarde, seguindo o exemplo do presidente Clinton, reconhece a sua culpa.
Cette image m'inspire une grande tristesse. Cette image représente pour moi un échec. J'ai essayé vainement de mobiliser l'opinion publique internationale pour obtenir une intervention au Rwanda et j'ai échoué. Une agression d'un État contre un autre peut mobiliser facilement l'opinion publique internationale, surtout si l'État qui est agressé est extrêmement riche en pétrole. Mais une guerre civile dans un coin perdu de l'Afrique n'intéresse pas l'opinion publique internationale. Je pense qu'il y avait une attitude délibérée de marginaliser ce conflit. La preuve, c'est que des instructions avaient été données pour ne pas utiliser le mot génocide. Cette photo est un symbole. Un être vivant qui est blessé et qui garde les traces de sa blessure a beaucoup plus de valeur symbolique qu'un être qui est mort. Les morts ne parlent pas. Cette photo représente la culpabilité de la communauté internationale.
James Natchi travaille pour l'agence Magno. Na primavera de 94, encontra-se na África do Sul, onde dá cobertura à eleição presidencial de Mandela. Chega ao Ruanda 5 semanas após o início do genocídio.
In the short term, I was too late. This picture was too late. It didn't really help anyone or save anyone or stop anything from happening. I think that it had already happened. So all I can hope for this picture is that it might serve some purpose in the long term, that it will serve all of our memory collectively. And then maybe next time, if something like this begins, we'll respond quicker. That, you know, the United Nations will send troops in instead of pulling them out, that we'll live up to our responsibilities. It's something I have to believe in to continue to do this work. Otherwise, I couldn't do it. I don't think I'll ever recover from what I saw in Rwanda. How they could summon the fear and the hatred is beyond my understanding. I just know that it happened. Shame and guilt are things we have to live with as journalists. You cannot witness suffering of this kind without feeling those emotions. And I think it's part of the price we pay to do our job.